I lost about $10,000 worth of shoes to Katrina. Those shoes are just like those high-end purses y'all have.
Yeah, they are.
I'm Paula Froelich. Take a journey with me to explore the unknown and discover the unexpected. This is Abroad Abroad. The adventure starts now.
This week marks the 10-year anniversary since New Orleans faced one of its biggest catastrophes ever. When the levees broke after Hurricane Katrina in 2005, it tore apart homes and families and devastated neighborhoods like the Lower Ninth Ward. But through it all, the unique cultural traditions of New Orleans have stayed strong, thanks to locals like Ronald Lewis. 10 years later, I visited Ronald in his backyard museum, the House of Dance and Feathers, which shows the history of the city's famous Mardi Gras Indians.
This is just the most intricate thing I think I've ever seen. It's just beautiful.
It's what we do in New Orleans. We're trading needles and feathers. We create family pieces of artwork. I always say we the Picassos with the trading needle.
Ooh, talk about haute couture. Some of Ronald's beadwork pieces have roots that trace back to the 1740s, when each Sunday, New Orleans' Congo Square was the place to be.
It's where the slaves would drum, chant, and dance with the Native Americans. And out of that interaction came the image of the black New Orleans Mardi Gras Indian.
Jump forward a few hundred years, and that's evolved into locals forming their own tribes and sewing together flashy costumes that can weigh over 100 pounds and take up to 9 months to build. In the Big Easy, you either go big or you go home.
Your tribe might be right here in this area, on the north side of Cleveland. The tribe, the Comanche and the Red Hawks. And everybody knew everybody, half of them married to each other, family members and stuff. But once we put those suits on, we're not friends.
No.
Dressing up might seem like fun and games, but not when there's pride on the line. At Mardi Gras celebrations, tribes taunt each other over who is the prettiest getup.
And then you made a whole business off of doing all the costumes.
No, it's not a business.
Okay.
It's just a passion for our culture. You know, somebody had to be the storyteller. But by living here in the Lower Nine, we had no such thing as what we call a museum.
Until Ronald filled the void and shared his own collection with the community.
Where's this one, the bead on the bottom with the...
It got lost in the storm.
But just 2 years after creating his own museum, Ronald and his wife were at a local hotel seeking shelter from Hurricane Katrina.
The storm came, the hotel fell apart that Monday. That Tuesday, I come out the hotel, the water coming up Canal Street out of Lake Pontchartrain.
That must have been terrifying.
I ain't have time to be terrified. It was time to go.
Ronald's home and museum were flooded with 14 feet of water.
I mean, that must have just broken your heart to come back and see your place.
Let me tell you. I didn't have time to have a broken heart. I'm at the top of the Lewis claim. So I had to lead the way of getting my family back home.
Did they do Mardi Gras?
We did do Mardi Gras 2006. And I tell you, that was the most somber Mardi Gras in my life. But we might have lost a lot of material stuff, but we did not lose our spirit.
The House of Dance and Feathers has since been reopened in a brand new building right behind Ronald's house.
Only thing I look forward to before I leave this earth are my community being made whole again.
While some predicted that this neighborhood would never recover from Katrina, the people who keep its traditions alive never doubted it. Their spirit is what makes New Orleans one of my favorite cities on earth.
Tell the world, come on down to the Little Night Wall and please come see the House of Dance and Feathers with Ronald W. Lewis.
On the next Abroad Abroad, I travel to Gulf Shores, Mississippi to meet one woman who kept 300 people alive.